Hi, my name is Wendy Crone. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Engineering Physics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I'd like to spend some time talking to you today about reading journal articles. There are three basic types of journal articles. One category is sometimes called letters or short communications. Another are just regular papers, journal papers. And a third are review articles. I'm going to spend most of our time today talking about papers and review articles. So I brought two with me. These are both from peer-reviewed journals. What that means is that these papers have gone through a process in which experts have looked at them and given feedback and evaluation of the articles themselves and the content of them, as well as an editor having looked at them, deciding both that they are of a high enough quality and the appropriate topic for the journal that they're published in. The two articles have a lot of similarities. One of them is a regular journal paper and the other one is a review article. But you'll find in almost every article the layout is quite similar for a number of pieces. So if we take a look at the journal article, for instance, the first thing you see at the top of the page is information about the article, its title and its abstract, as well as information about the authors and their affiliations, so where the authors are located. You'll also find in most journal articles information about the corresponding author, and this is identifying one individual who will receive correspondences about the content of the paper and answer further questions. The other thing that you're going to see on the front page of most of these articles is information about the journal and where it's published. It'll give you the citation information, the year in which it was published, and the journal name, etc. So there are a number of things that I wanted to talk about that give you some idea of the bigger scope of the article. And one of these other pieces is also found on the front page, sometimes on the front and sometimes back further in the article. But in this particular case, it's right here underneath the authors. And this is information about the timeline for publication. It tells you when the article was first received and when the manuscript was first received by the journal. When it was accepted for publication, and then the final publication date. This gives you information about when the research was conducted. It had to have been conducted prior to the date from which it was received, but it also gives you information about how quickly this particular journal takes articles to publication. So if you're thinking about submitting an article to a journal, you might want to take a look at the timelines from several articles that are in the journal currently to see how long their publication timeline tends to be. There, as I mentioned, there's some information on the front about affiliations of the authors, and there's also a little bit of information at the back of each paper, usually in a section called Acknowledgements, that gives you an idea of who funded the work that was conducted. So it may have been funded by a federal agency or a national lab or a private foundation or an industry, and that gives you information about who is concerned who's involved in the concern of creating this research. If, for instance, it's industry-sponsored research, you might look at the article a little bit differently than if it were funded by a federal agency. There's some other layout pieces that are very similar in both of these articles in that they both have introductions. Sometimes this is called background, but the introduction gives you the basic lay of the land as far as what's been done already in this particular field. Within the introduction, you're going to see a number of citations, and these citations are referring back to the references at the end of the article, and these references are an excellent source for additional information. The introduction is also going to give you a framework for understanding where the information in this particular article stands with respect to other work that's already been conducted in the field. Let me talk about the review article for just a moment. Review articles generally do not include any new findings within a review article. What a review article is doing is surveying an area of research and putting all of those pieces together and in context. And a really good review article is going to synthesize and analyze a little bit and do some further analysis of the prior research that's been done. but it's talking in a more general sense about what's going on in a particular area of study. In this particular article, it's a critical review of adhesion in surface micromechanical structures, and it provides a wonderful background in the topic area, as well as information about prior research that's been conducted. And you'll often find that one of the key important pieces of a review article are all the references that have been collected. In this particular case, there's 78 references cited, and these are excellent places for further information that might be relevant to the interest that you have as far as reading the literature. The standard papers have a general format that they tend to follow. Usually there's an introduction and or background section. There is then a section on methods or techniques, whether it be experimental, analytical, or theoretical. And then the results are presented. And then at the end of the paper, there's a discussion and conclusions. These may be put together in one section, or they may have a separate discussion and a separate conclusion section. So how do you read a journal article? So I get that question all the time. How do I get information out of these journal articles? And I'll tell you my strategy, and you may end up developing your own strategy that works well for you. But what I usually do is take a look at abstracts, and I usually do this online. Read abstracts from searches that I do with literature search engines, and determine whether or not the abstract hints at something that I might be further interested in. And then I get a copy of the paper, and I usually end up flipping to the back first and taking a look at the conclusions of the paper and to determine whether or not there's something in between that I might be interested in. If it looks enticing, then I'll go back and start at the beginning, reading the paper from front to end, but reading it rather quickly. And I do this read as a way to get a general scope of what's going on. Having read the conclusions ahead of time, I sort of know where they're heading with what they're doing. And then I'm going through and doing a fast read, and if I run into things I don't understand or equations that are confusing, just skip them over the first time through. If I find that the article is actually quite relevant to the research that I'm doing, then I follow that up with a second or a third read that's much more thorough and detailed, where I go and figure out all of the bits and pieces that I might not have understood on that cursory read the first time through. The other important piece is that as I'm reading, I'm noting individual citations that I might want to also take a look at. This paper is giving me their interpretation of those other works, but if it's particularly relevant to my interests, I need to go and read that original paper myself, and their references will give me the information to be able to go and find that information as well. The other strategy, and it's a strategy I use quite frequently, especially when I'm reading experimental papers, is to go through and take a look at the figures and read the figures before reading the text. Figures, because I'm an experimentalist, I can learn a lot from just reading the figures alone and draw my own conclusions. Then when I go back and read the text of the paper, I can compare these conclusions to what the authors have drawn. This is actually a good process of reading because it's helping you to read critically and question what it is that the authors are saying and what the authors are presenting. Particularly in the discussion section of a paper, it's important to question the discussion and conclusions that have been drawn because oftentimes there's interpretation that goes about in going from results to the conclusions that the authors are drawn. And you may not agree with that path that they've taken, and you may have other conclusions from the raw data and results that have been presented. So those are some strategies for looking at journal articles. The other thing that I wanted to point out is that not everything in print is correct. So it's important to realize that even though it's been through a peer-reviewed process, which is oftentimes very, very thorough, still mistakes get through. These could be simple mistakes like typographical errors, which could be problematic if they're in an equation, or they could be errors in the technique that was used. You may know more details about the experimental technique and be able to identify errors that were introduced into the results because of the technique that was employed. There also could be errors in the discussion and the conclusions that they're drawn. There may be misinterpretations of the data. So even though it's in publication, it is still open to interpretation, and that's something to keep in mind when you're reading a journal article. You should read it critically and question what's being said by the authors. So that's my basic advice, and I think the closing remark that I will give you is that journal articles get easier to read the more you have read, so keep reading, and you'll find that you'll actually learn a lot from taking a look at a variety of different journal articles and exploring what they're presenting.